We're going to take you now live to Ukraine. And Pavlo Kukhta is a Ukrainian politician and former minister in Volodymyr Zelensky's government. He's currently in Lviv in western Ukraine and joins us now live. Thank you so much for being with us. I just wondered if you could describe the last couple of days to our audience. What have you been doing and what have you been seeing on the ground?
Well, thanks for having me. The last couple of days have been hellish, I'd say. I mean, it's a real war, large-scale war, the largest in Europe since World War II, in fact. We've had bombings, we had planes over us. Just, you know, to give an illustration to you and your viewers, my ex-wife actually had a Russian interceptor shot down from the skies by Ukrainian Air Force right above her house, with the pilot bailing out, dropping into a river, being fished out of there by her neighbors and given over to the police. So this is the kind of normal experience now in this country, right? Just a simple story of one person. This is how we've been living these last 2 days. There is a massive wave of evacuation coming from capital Kyiv, because it turned out that the Russian main point of attack was the capital, actually. The worst scenario they could have taken to try to take the heart of Ukraine. This is the largest city in Kyiv, so millions of people are flowing west. We are currently leave because I had to evacuate the family, so we had to bring everyone out. I've spent, I think, about 38 hours at the wheels with about 2 hours of sleep, so I'm sorry if I might be a little messy in my speaking or something. It really, you know, keeps you at the nerves. Once I settled the situation with the family, I plan to probably return to Kyiv to participate in the territorial defense or do something else for the defense of the country. It's literally a people's war here, with thousands crowding in front of military commissions to sign up, mostly for the territorial defense units, which are given weapons from the government. It's easy to register, easy to sign up. People take up weapons, kind of occupy their territories, try to protect them. It's the tactic Ukraine uses against the Russian warfare, because the Russians control the skies, so they control the open areas. Then Ukraine defends the cities, and the territorial units are quite helpful in that regard. This is kind of, in a nutshell, what's going on here. This day wasn't calm. There was constant combat on the front lines, heavy combat by any standards. But at least there were no major changes in the situation, so it's more or less the same. In the evening right now, it's evening here in Ukraine, as it was in the morning. We'll see what night brings. Usually the Russians try to attack somewhere at night, in the morning, and then by day they try to kind of change the situation. But make no mistake, this is a major war, and, you know, it's clearly a major unprovoked war, right? It's so unjustified that it's kind of borders disbelief.
Pavlo, you are currently in the west of Ukraine. You said to me that you're intending to return to Kyiv and take up some sort of military position and try and offer some sort of opposition to Russian forces. Can you give us an insight as to the Ukrainian resistance? Because despite pledges from more than 20 countries to provide the Ukrainian government with military assistance, clearly the Ukrainian people are outgunned when it comes to military capacity. The Russian army and its resources are significant. So why are Ukrainians fighting?
Well, again, it's a people's war. So Mr. Putin has managed to solidify the nation in something unprecedented, right? Essentially, even people with pro-Russian sympathies, who I personally know, have none after these 2 days. Literally, you won't find a pro-Russian person in Ukraine anymore, ever, I guess. So everyone is consolidated. Everyone is defending their nation. It's not about politicians. It's not about ideologies. It's simply about the people, the nation, the country defending itself, which is why there is such a massive wave of support. So everyone is fully on the same page, and those who aren't fighting are being supported, fed by those who are not fighting. That is what's happening. So Ukrainians are defending. If we're talking about Ukrainian armed forces, they've actually shown a very surprising, even to me, though I know from inside Ukrainian government and the armed forces, a surprising amount of resilience and capacity. So Ukrainian Air Force, Ukrainian anti-air which was significantly weaker than Russia, never modernized as Russia did, was underinvested compared to Russia, and was expected to be wiped out in the first days of the war, continues fighting. The Russian planes are being shot out of the sky. Ukrainian planes attack Russian troops on the ground. The system functions. And in fact, we even have an ace. So we have a pilot who has shot down, I believe, 6 or 7 planes by now in only 2 days. That is what is treated as an ace in the military. So even the Air Force, which is most dependent on money, and where the Russia was supposed to have the most advantage, even there, Ukraine is quite capable of fighting. On the ground, it's even more than that, because Ukrainian soldiers are very motivated. And the Russian soldiers do not seem motivated by any extent. Generally, they try to push somewhere. If they face resistance, they retreat. On the internet, there are multitudes of videos of them falling into an ambush, being shot dead. There are big casualties, probably on both sides. I'm careful always about any official estimates. You know, after 2 days of fighting, we'll probably know the true numbers only after the conflict. But it's clear that the Russians are suffering major losses. If we, you know, look at the results of the conflict so far, the Russian military is not such a powerful thing as it was supposed to be, or Ukrainian military is significantly more powerful than people expected it to be.
Pavlo, the world's eyes have been on Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky. Despite offers from France and the United States to help him escape Ukraine into a safer position, he's so far refused, saying he will stay and fight. You were a minister in his government. What can you tell us about Volodymyr Zelensky?
Look, he is quite a character. I resigned at some point from his government, so I have my own reservations. But those are quite meaningless when we have a total war in our country. He is the commander-in-chief. He has his job. It is his job. It is his job to have guts, to have balls, and to stay in the capital when the capital is being defended. And he's doing that quite admirably. So, fine by me. I mean, we rally around the flag in this situation, whatever our political, what we like and what we don't like. If I may add, I would like to add something important, which is a message to the West, because ultimately the fate of the conflict very much rests on the shoulders of the West. Russia is a heavyweight compared to Ukraine. It is unlikely that Ukraine would be able to defeat it alone. And the West's help is needed, but it does not mean that the Western soldiers have to fight there. What it means is that the Western sanctions have to be tough enough for Russia to be crippled economically. And ideally, that would really help. A no-fly zone should be introduced over Ukraine. The Russian planes should be thrown away. NATO should not allow them to fly over Ukraine, Russian planes and missiles. This would even level the playing field between the two armies. And then with these, with tough sanctions in place, Russia cut off from SWIFT, the international payment system, which seems to already be happening. Russian central bank accounts frozen, which seems to be in the work. There are already articles in the media that the Biden administration is contemplating that. And with the no-fly zone in place, this war will be won by Ukraine with Western support. And this will stop Vladimir Putin and in his tracks, and he will not go further than Ukraine anywhere. This will be the end of his regime. And I think that is the best outcome we can get out of this.
Pavlo, I have one last question, and it is a difficult question. I know you have been awake for the best part of 2 days. I know you are trying to help your family into safety, but it's your intention to return to Kiev and fight. Are you prepared to die for your country?
If necessary. You know, no one likes to die, but it's a life or death situation here, literally, for the country. So if necessary, people will be sacrificing their lives, me as well. Of course, we would prefer not to. We would prefer to throw the Russians out. That's what we would like to do.